Hey, welcome to Toyota Time with Timmy the Tool Man and Sean.
And
special guest Fred,
hailing from Sacramento. And the dog.
Okay, so what we're going to do today is we are going to replace the lower control arm bushings that live in here, and there's another one back here, there, and there. We're going to change those bushings out. Fred, why are we doing this? Are you having any issues?
I'm not, but they have 216,000 miles on them, and I don't believe that they're lifetime wear items like Toyota says. Might as well do them while we have the chance.
These things do actually fail. We've seen them on the Toyota forums where they'll take the lower control arm. They'll show tons of slop. So if you have maybe a front end shimmy, maybe you can't get the thing aligned right because it keeps on going out of alignment because those bushings will affect your cam adjusters. Those are some issues that you can be experiencing. An alignment problem, maybe a front end shimmy that you can't figure out and you suspect that it actually is the lower control arm bushings. So those are some reasons why. What we are gonna use for references again is factory service manual. It's an invaluable source. The pages that reference this is in the suspension and axle starts on SA63. And this shows a very good blow up schematic of the steering rack, which we do have to remove to get the bolts out of the lower control arm. It gives you all the torque specs here for the outer tie rods, for the different brackets and bolts that hold the steering rack on. And then it also gives you the torque specs for the lower shock bolt that we have to take out. It discusses all the torque specs for the cam adjuster bolts. Nice schematic. So this is all on page SA63. And then it goes into the steps of how you would do it. You remove the front wheel. It says remove the steering gear assembly, but what we're gonna do is just loosen the steering rack from the cross member and lift it up a little bit with the jack so we can get the bolts free from the lower control arm. We're gonna remove the sway bar. We're gonna also disconnect the lower ball joint and the lower shock bolt. And then we can work on getting the cam adjusters and make match marks first, so we can get the cam adjusters back in the correct spot. And then it goes through all the steps of how they would do it at a factory level with their press and special tools, but we've got our own method we're gonna be showing. So those are all the pages. I took notes. Here's a list of how we're gonna do it. The first thing we've got is we block the steering wheel. Why you wanna lock the steering wheel is because when you start removing the steering rack, if you don't lock the steering wheel, you're going to have a problem getting the steering wheel back centered the way it should be. So this prevents you from messing up the alignment of your steering wheel. We're going to chalk one of the rear wheels fore and aft. The parking brake is on. Jack up the front end, support it on frames with 6-ton jack stands. We're removing the front wheels. We're going to remove the skid pans front and rear. We're going to remove the sway bar and the end links. We're gonna disconnect both the outer tie rods on both sides, at which they connect to the knuckle of the lower ball joint. We're gonna loosen the steering rack from the cross member. So we're gonna take all the bolts that hold the steering rack to the cross member. Then we're gonna disconnect the lower shock bolt on one side. Then we're gonna disconnect the lower control arm from the lower ball joint with a puller. We're gonna make match marks on all four of the cam plates so we can get the thing back in the right position when we put it back together. We're gonna remove the cam adjusting bolts. Then we're gonna be able to take the lower control arm off the vehicle. We're gonna do our method that we learned online to press out the lower control arm bushings. We're gonna press in the new ones, which he's gonna use aftermarket white line poly bushings. Then we're gonna reinstall the lower control arm, get the cam adjusters back where they should be. We're gonna reconnect the lower ball joint. And then we're going to repeat that whole procedure with the other side. Since this is a good time because you have the steering rack already disconnected, if you haven't replaced your steering rack bushings, you might want to consider replacing the bushings because you already got everything disconnected. And then we're going to bolt the steering rack back up to the cross member. We're going to reinstall the sway bar. We're going to reconnect the outer tie rod, get the wheels back on. And then finally, Fred is going to drive back to Sacramento and get an alignment. You know, you want to get an alignment. Other things that you want to do, since you got the sway bar off the vehicle already, you might want to replace your sway bar bushings and end link bushings, because that's another thing that you got to take off. Another thing that you might want to consider replacing if you haven't done it yet is your lower ball joints. We've covered this in other videos that these have a high incidence of failure. So if you have a lot of miles on your rig and you haven't changed the lower ball joints yet, or you bought it used and you're not unsure, this is a good time to replace the lower ball joints at the same time. So, looking at the rig, like we said earlier, we've got the frame supported on 6-ton jack stands. We have one of the rear wheels, the right rear wheel, chopped fore and aft. The parking brake is on. We also have the steering wheel locked in place, so when we remove the steering rack, it's not going to throw off the steering wheel alignment. The next thing we're going to do is get the skid plates off, work on getting the steering rack disconnected from the frame. One thing that I wanted to say before we get started on tearing the front end of the truck apart is that for this repair, we're going to emphasize the lower control arm bushing removal, not necessarily the steering rack bushing job, because we already covered that in another video. We're going to show some of that, but if you want greater detail of removing the steering rack from the cross member and replacing those bushings, go to that video that we made on that subject. And also with the removal and the replacement of the sway bar, go to that same video because we cover all that, the torque specs and how we removed it from the truck. Again, we're going to concentrate on the method to get the lower control arm free of the vehicle and how to press out the old bushings and get new bushings back in and get everything back together. Here's some torque specs. So these are the torque specs right here in regards to the steering rack. So on the driver's side, there's a large bolt that goes through that cross member, and that one is torqued to 141 foot-pounds. There's a middle bolt that goes perpendicular to the ground, and that one is torqued to 123 foot-pounds. The passenger side bracket, the nut and the bolt are both torqued to 123 foot-pounds. The torque specs related to the removal and replacement of the lower control arm, the cam adjusting bolts are at 96 foot-pounds. The lower shock bolt is 101 foot-pounds. The outer tie rod castle nut, that's 67 foot-pounds. The lower ball joint castle nut is 105 foot-pounds. And the sway bar end links are 51 foot-pounds. And he has aftermarket ones, so I don't know if that's going to correspond, but that's the torque spec. And then I did take a bunch of notes of everything that we did from the steering rack so I wouldn't forget. So I actually watched my own video and took notes, size sockets and everything like that. So anyway, so we're going to start off by skid plates off, so that saves us some room. And we're going to work on getting the steering rack disconnected from the frame and the outer tie rods disconnected. All right, we're going to get going. I'm going to get the outer tie rod disconnected from the knuckle of the lower ball joint. I'm just using this DeWalt cordless impact with a 19 millimeter socket and a long impact extension. We've removed the cotter pin out of the castle nut, and we're just going to remove this. So I probably got the right combo. I got a long 19 millimeter impact socket with a short extension. I'm just going to loosen this up. There we go. And that's loose. Now we're going to have to get one of our little pullers and break this outer tie rod from the lower ball joint knuckle. Okay, we're using this long jaw puller. Right, you see here, we've got the tines in between the knuckle of the lower ball joint, in between the boots right here. So I'm not pulling on the boot, I'm just pulling on this knuckle, and this is going to drive down and break the tie rod free.
Oh, it just fell out.
Yeah, I literally just put them in.
Whatever. There's four cam plates. So there's one here, there's one on the back side here, this is the front of the vehicle, and then there's one here, and then there's one here. So there's four of them. So we're making match marks, so we're making at least two match marks. Here you can see that what we're going to label these is this one's going to be front, this one's going to be front rear, this one's going to be rear front, and this one's going to be rear. And so we're going to make two match marks. So you can see on this first one, the front rear, I'm marking in two spots. So I'm marking the cam plate and I'm marking in silver on the frame where it connects, so we can get the cam adjusters back where they were. So clean it up really good first and then mark them. So what we have done is the steering rack, you can see, is free. We got this bracket off. We got this bolt that goes perpendicular to the ground. We got this big bolt that goes through this whole cross member out. We disconnected the boot, and the idea is, see how tight it is to get this bolt out. So with the boot out of the way, we're hoping that we can sneak the bolt right past here. So we want to be able to get it out. If we can't get it out, then we might have to disconnect maybe the steering up here. But we're hopeful that by just moving the rack, we could get it out enough of the way to where we can pull that bolt out and free it of the frame. Okay, so we got all the cam adjusters marked in two spots. And now, in order to be able to get the control arm free, we have to disconnect this lower shock bolt. And then we have to disconnect the lower ball joint from the lower control arm. So this is a 19 millimeter. Okay, you gotta remove the cotter pin, and now we gotta get this sucker off. I don't know what size this is, can't remember. That's not that size. I think it's 24. Yes, it is. Okay, it's a 24 millimeter. Why am I yelling? 24 millimeter. And we're gonna disconnect this. That was the castle nut for the lower ball joint. Now we gotta break it free. Okay, we're gonna get a puller on the lower ball joint. I'm using this Pittman arm puller from the kit I have. Just gotta make sure that you get it. You get the tines of the puller in between the knuckle and the boot. You don't wanna get on the boot and mess up the boot. Just double check that's not grabbing the boot. This might come out with a little bit of force, so get any small children or pets out of the way. There we go. Just heavy, huh? Yeah. It's broken free for sure now. Okay. Yeah, so he's got these beefy Icon shocks, and there's a lot of pressure on it to where we can't just like lift this off easily. So what we're gonna do is just put this castle nut back on a little bit, and then we'll work on getting these cam bolts out, and then maybe the whole thing as one could just fall out once we get these out of here. What we got here is we're on the passenger side. We've disconnected the boot from the steering rack on this side, and we've got the steering rack supported over here with this jack stand, pushing it up as far as it'll go. It's basically up against the front drive shaft, and we're finding that we can get a socket on here to use the impact gun, but you got to be careful that you don't hit the shaft. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna put this, like, double up a rag and put the rag there. It's a smooth extension, but I still want to maybe just do a little extra protection while I try to get this thing off. Okay, that might work. Yeah, so I just got a rag wrapped up a couple times, and in between the impact extension, this is the inner tie rod. Okay. It's a 19 on the... So we got a 22 millimeter impact socket, short socket with an extension with the gun here over to the right where he's not pointing. And then we've got a 19 millimeter ratcheting wrench on the back side, and we'll see how this is gonna work. We're gonna try it. It's turning. God, the thing is... Ooh, that just dropped. Okay, it's on my leg. Okay. All right. Okay, so that worked. We got it loose. See, it's moving out when I turn it, and then if I turn it the other way, it should go the opposite direction. It's going back in. So that's kind of how those cam adjusters work, and that's why you want to make match marks so you don't screw up your alignment when you're doing this. Just take it off the rest of the way. So let's remember. Oh, get off of there. Let's remember this orientation. So the bolt, well, I guess we will remember because the bolt had to clear this, so we probably won't forget that, but this goes on the inside and of the control arm, and this goes out towards the steering rack, the big bolt. So now, moment of truth, is this thing's gonna actually clear this. Is it clearing?
It's close.
Okay, so I don't know if you saw that, but the washer was hanging us up. The washer is just a little bit bigger diameter than the bolt. So push the washer towards the frame, and then slide the bolt out, and then you can get the whole thing out. Okay, the next hurdle is getting this out, this bolt, the cam adjuster. So It has to come out from the other side, back towards the rear of the vehicle, back towards the steering rack. And sometimes these things are really welded in there. We got lucky. I just took a little pry bar on the other side and pulled on, pried on the cam, and it started moving right away. So I think we're pretty lucky. I think if you're in the rust belt of the country, this might be a real hassle to get that free. I just grabbed this little pry bar and just got underneath there and pried it free. And now you'll see that this cam with it pointing upward is not gonna clear this at all. So we're gonna have to twist this down like this and then get it to where it'll clear the inner tie rod. But before we get that one free and not put undue tension on this front one, we're gonna break this one free first, get it ready to come out, and then try to get them both out like right close at the same time. Okay, now we're using the impact gun, 22 millimeter socket again on the front with a 19 millimeter ratcheting wrench in the back, and we're gonna break this front connection free. Okay, so you could see how this comes together. So you got the long bolt coming in from the front with a washer. You got the rear. We got to mark, see how we got it marked front rear, and we got to mark two spots. And then now we have to get this cam adjuster out. Oh, look at that, cool. Like downtown. Look at that. So we came to the realization that there was a lot of force being put on the outer joint of the CV axle, and same on the upper ball joint. So we've got a ratchet strap kind of run to the top of the shock tower and then wrapped around the caliper, and we're just jacking this thing up now to support it. So now we're going to try to get this cam out of here. And this thing is out of my way. What if we just pull the steering rack out a little more? There we go. It's out. So you just have to mess around with the jack a little bit, pull on the steering rack. We finally got this one out. And this is the tough one. This cam adjuster is the harder one to clear because you have to deal with getting it past the inner tie rod of the steering rack. So we've got the rear cam adjusters out. So you see rear front, and then you got rear. This bolt slides through this adjuster. And then when you turn this, this is the camming action. So I just reassembled it and see how it fits in there. So it will turn, they'll turn together right there. See how that goes together? And it fits in. So they turn as one unit. So I just put it back together so we'll remember how it goes. Now we gotta get this front one free, and this should pretty much fall out. I'm gonna get a pry bar in there, and then we'll free it, and then we'll get the castle nut off. Let me get a big pry bar. Just use a pry bar, see if we can free this a little bit. It's moving a little bit at a time. We're going back and forth on both sides. Okay, that seems pretty free. Now I think I can maybe just work it out with my hands. Work it.
How are you?
Howdy. Ta-da! That's a lower control arm. All right. Now, howdy.
Those washers on it.
Oh. You sure?
These are those.
Those are, yeah. This is the whole kit, right?
Yeah.
It's gotta be. I thought these were just a full bolt-on thing. Is there directions for these? It must be the washers replace them.
You might be right.
So we've got the lower control arm in a vise now. The way the bushing is made, this right here, that's a metal sleeve. This is part of the control arm, but this right here is the sleeve of the bushing. Then it's rubber next, and then this sleeve goes in between the rubber. And so here's a way to check and show that this one at least was worn out. Look at that movement in the bushing. I'm not putting a whole lot of force. and that thing's moving a lot. You can actually see a little bit of separation of the rubber here. So that's pretty loose. Now you go over here to this one, and I'm putting a lot of pressure, and that bushing is in a lot better shape. So this one up here was a little worn out, and so Fred made a good choice to replace these. The next thing we're gonna do is we're gonna try to press these out. There's a couple different methods. Some people do this really involved procedure of heating it up and melting the whole thing out. Some people get a bottle jack in here, which we might actually try. Put a little pressure, heat this up, and pop it out. We're first gonna try to use a ball joint press and see if we can get a sleeve over here to push this thing out. So that's gonna be our first try to actually push it out with a ball joint press. If that fails, we're gonna try to do the bottle jack in between here, apply a little pressure, heat this up with a torch, and get it to pop out. So we tried the ball joint press over here. We gave this a shot, but it's pretty wide to get in between the arms, and so we're gonna give up on this because we couldn't really get a big socket. I thought maybe we'd get a big breaker bar, but because this is so long and the distance between the control arms is only so much, we had to do it with an open end wrench, and we weren't gonna get enough force. And I was hoping we'd get a big breaker bar. So now we're going this direction. We've got a 12 ton bottle jack, and it's going right in between the two arms, in between the bushing. We've got the bushing there and the bushing here. So as I crank on this, you'll see it start to compress the just pushing on the rubber right now. And now it's meeting. Now it's compressing back here a little bit. And now it's getting tight. So I don't want to go too tight. The next step is going to put a little heat on this, and then hopefully this thing's going to pop free. And to prevent this from being a projectile, my idea is we're going to get a bucket with maybe some rags in it as a backstop. So in case it wants to go out more than just a little bit, we're going to catch it and it's not going to go through the side of my house or somebody down the street. Okay, that's pretty tight. Okay, there in YouTube land, this is our setup. 12-ton bottle jack. I've got it to where it's kind of maxed out. The rubber's kind of pushing out. There's tension on here, but I'm not putting a ton of force, or I might do some damage to these control arms. Sean is holding a bucket as a backstop with a bunch of rags in it.
That's our backstop.
Then the video we saw that the guys did this, and when they heated this up, it just popped out a little bit. But I'm not gonna bet on that. That's only gonna pop out a little bit. I'm thinking it might just be a projectile, and I want to avoid that. I've got pressure on it. Don't do this at home, kiddies. Okay, we're gonna. Let's see if this works. There we go.
That's loose.
I just needed to have a little more pressure on. I went conservative because I was just scared to do damage to the control arm. But if I had a little more pressure on it, it would have popped out and broke free. So now we just got to drive this out the rest of the way. There we go. And that's going to be hot, so probably not grab it with these kind of gloves. So I'm not burning yet, so. There we go. There's one. So this is what it looks like. You see the metal. Ooh, smells good, like burnt rubber. Metal sleeve, rubber on the inside, and then the sleeve, this metal sleeve that goes in between. So that's a little toasty. You want to feel it? Okay. Now we got to do the same with the other side. Okay, we're going for the other side now. So that one's free. Little torch action. Backstop. That's what those guys said in the video. He goes, every time it scares the crap out of me.
Oh, look at that thing go.
Okay, let me get the rag. It's going to burn the crap out of my hands. Probably should do this with regular, better gloves than this, but let me grab it. There we go. Okay. That's how you do it, people. So we're gonna clean this up, maybe a little emery cloth, maybe some steel wool. Yeah, steel wool. So I'm just cleaning up the inside of these control arms with some steel wool so that when the new ones go in, there'd be just less resistance and less junk in the way. So they're a little bit rusty, but not bad. So just clean them up really good. And so these are the new white line poly bushings. It's got a sleeve, kind of similar design. Is that so hot? Not bad. So this is the new design, but this thing doesn't have a constant diameter. It only gets tight right here. So when you slide it in, it starts to get tight right there. So this is where we're going to be pressing this in. We'll probably press it in using the vise. I've seen it online where that's what the guys did. It just gets tight right there. So right here, there's slop. So slide it in. Comes with some bushing lubricant. So we're going to lubricate this, put a little on the sleeve, pop this in, and then the way it goes together with the sleeve, just imagine the sleeve is in here. You got a washer here, and then you'll have a washer on this side. So it'll basically mimic the OEM bushing. So first of all, we're going to get a little bit of lubricant in here and get that sleeve in. So it might take a little bit of finagling around to get it lined up if it wants to pop out on you, but now we've got it lined up and it's just going to slide right on in. Just like downtown. Okay, that's in there. We got the jaws of the vise pushing up against the bushing. We were hoping we could actually get an adapter and be pushing on a sleeve, but my vise doesn't go that wide, so we got a receiving cup from a ball joint press on the other side that's equal to the diameter. We're just going to push it in. Hopefully it's not going to be too hard. Let me get this lined a little better. Okay. All right, so let's see if that goes in. No problem. I don't know. I don't like the fact that it's pushing on that. Let's do, the guy used a channel lock, so I remember that, so let's just try that. Okay, so we can't take credit for this. So the guy, in his infinite wisdom, he used the channel locks, and I remember this now, I just forgot that he used the channel lock. So you see now the channel locks is what's contacting the vise and the sleeve right here. It's not the bushing, so we're not pushing on the bushing anymore. So now we're just gonna drive it in, and we got this receiving cup on the other side. Is that bending that thing? I hope not.
Ooh, that sounded interesting.
In there. Yep. Spotted. That's the way to do it. Channel locks. So we put we decided that maybe if you ever had to do this again, maybe it'd be better to put a little anti-seize in here. So we put a little anti-seize on the inside diameter of the control arm and on the outer part of the sleeve. And then, so remember, you get the channel locks or something like it to where it's going to contact the metal outside sleeve, and then you have a receiving cup to where the bushing could be pushed into somewhere. So the receiving cup goes like that, just like that. Now we're going to do the other side.
Arm's done.
Okay.
So what's this guy right here? Maybe you could tell everybody what that's all about.
It's a Wheeler's off-road, I think they call them super bumps. It's like this big rubber bump stop, and it looks like it's way too big for the application. But there's a video of it on YouTube of someone testing them out, and they compress to like halfway or even a little more than half. So they're just like pretty plush when you're off-roading. I recommend them, they're pretty soft.
Fred decided to buy some new parts for this job, all the cam adjusters, so all the pieces that come together. So again, this is an old one where you got this side with the sleeve that slides in there with the bolt that goes all the way through with the washer. So here's a new one that he bought, and this is the part number for it, this 48452-35020. And so he bought four of those. Yeah, four. And then here's the bolt that goes through the whole assembly with a new washer, and he's got four of these. And that part number is 90080-11283. And then the part, like the camming part, that the sleeve, this thing right here that we made marks on, this is part number 48409-35050. And it's the same partner for all four. They're all the same. Now, do you need to do this? No, you don't need to do this. You could actually just clean up, like some of these, you know, are a little rusted. You could take some, like we did to clean up the lower control arms. You could take some steel wool. You could take some emery cloth, clean it up really good, and you're good to go. But Fred just decided to buy new ones, and that's fine. You know, either clean them up really good and reinstall them, or buy new ones like he did. Okay, I wanted to show you, so you could see that it's oblong, so it gives you an ability to turn those and adjust the wheel. So it's the same on, you know, all the sides. It's got an oblong slot. And over here in the rear, it's the same thing. You got the oblong slot. So we're assembling the new adjusters, and we're going to get the control arm back in. The long sleeve, I don't know if we should probably get one. Or this jobber right here, the sleeve that the cam adjuster is attached to on the front, goes in like this. So goes in like so. Then in between the frame member, you got to put this washer right. It's right up against the frame right here. So that's a washer that we added in. So you have to kind of fiddle with it, like holding the arm up while you're getting this adjuster through, and then get that washer in between the bushing and the frame. And then as you slide it through, then you got to get the second washer lined up, which is a little bit, you know, hard, but having extra hands helps. And then you go to the other side and you put the other adjuster that you made the marks on. And so now we're going to get the bolt through. We put a little anti-seize on it. So we used this anti-seize, and we're just going to put a little anti-seize on the bolt, and now we're going to slide it through. And we're not going to get all the way tight, we're just going to get started. Well, we'll get the other one on there first, the rear one set up, and then we'll make sure that these match marks match up on both the front and the rear on both sides. So I was pulling the boot back. Sean was kind of holding the tie rod a little bit out of the way. It takes a little work, but you can get this adjuster. So you have to turn this adjuster, cam adjuster, this way to get it past the inner tie rod and slide it in place. And then just finagle around with this steering rack to where you can finally slide this through. So the rear one, the sleeved one with the attached cam adjuster, goes from the back towards the front. And then just rotate it into place, and now we got to get another washer on the other side. So we got a washer now in between. We got a washer again between the frame member and the bushing, and we got to get another one in here. It looks like that might be a little hard to get in there. Push on it.
Oh yeah,
just like downtown. Okay, we were wrong. It was just the inner sleeve. It was just the inner sleeve of the bushing that slid out from its perch a little bit. So I'm gonna fit this thing in here like butter.
Oh, yeah.
Is it almost lined up?
Yeah, that's pretty much in there.
There we go.
Yeah, a little bit close? Higher up. There we go. Try again.
There we go. Sweet. So now the adjuster is through the other side. Yeah, we got washers. Now washers in between. So just make sure you get the washers in between. And now we got to get the back part on. So now we got to get this bolt through here. Get this in the way. Get the washer ahead of you so it's past this. And then there we go.
Ooh.
Now we got to get this on the other side. I can't see what I'm doing, but
you're pretty in there.
Yeah. Okay, that's good. That's good. Good to start right now. Now I'm just gonna adjust this so you turn it to where you line back up your match marks. So that's looking pretty good right there on that side. And how's it looking over there, Brad? Can you see it?
It's pretty close, yeah.
Okay, so The cams only go together really one way. So you get them together and then they turn as one unit. And that's what you're after. So when you turn them and one set of match marks matches up, then the other, if you put the thing back together correctly, so both of the adjusters should be facing the same way. They have a way where they go up and away from the bolt in a half moon, and then the same thing on the opposite side. You got to match them up. Let's try this side now. So I'm going to rotate this one in place.
All right. Oh, about the right there.
Right there?
Yeah.
Good.
Okay, yeah, and these are looking good. So that's the way you do it. So you just have to double check that you're matched up on both sides, and you should be good to go.
Should be is the key word there.
So I have a 19 millimeter gear wrench on the opposite side. Holding that still, I've got a 22 millimeter, a half inch drive socket, and I'm just tightening it up a little bit. Or hopefully, a goal is just to tighten it up to where it's not going to move on us, but we could still move the lower control arm. So, and then we'll be torquing these down later on. But how much? That's still got pretty good movement. Still move it. All right. I say we'll be good right there. And now it's kind of cinched up, or hopefully the cam adjusters aren't going to move on us. And we'll do the same with the other one. So we're doing the rear one now. So again, I've got the gear wrench, ratcheting wrench, 19 millimeter on the back with a 22 millimeter with a long extension to get past the outer tie rod. Take another look at that fret. Is that looking pretty good?
Yeah, it looks good.
Is this lined up pretty good?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, it's looking pretty good. So we're just going to cinch these down, but not torque them all the way. Okay. All right, so we got that started. All right, so to get the help to get assembly back up and connected, we put a jack with like this plastic piece of like bendo board, plastic 2x4 underneath the rotor, and then jacked it up a little bit, and then we were able to get it to where then we can get the lower castle nut of the ball joint connected, and then also we've got the bolt and the nut started for the lower shock bolt. So now we can torque all this stuff together and work on the other side. So this lower shock bolt goes to 101 foot-pounds. If you're wondering the relation, the bolt comes through the backside, the nut and the washer go on the front. Doesn't appear that we have to hold the backside, it's staying put. That's it. 101 foot-pounds.
Nice and fast.
There we go. Whole thing was spinning.
Woo.
There we go. Okay. The torque on the lower ball joint is 104 foot-pounds. Always use a new cotter pin. Cut a little bit of this off. It's a little bit long. I usually don't have problems with being too long, but yeah. God, I wish we could get the. Now, I wish this was up a little bit, but. With the jack.
Boom, boom.
Okay.
Boom, boom, boom.
Now we gotta do the same thing.
I would
let's just adjust it.
Like just a tiny bit, counterclockwise. I just had it too.
22?
Yeah.
Spinning the whole thing. Okay, let's see if I can adjust that a little more. So tell me when you think good. Like right there? Ooh. That looks pretty darn good on this eye.
That's pretty close. Okay. Yeah, that's very close.
Okay,
that's
now...
That's better.
That's good.
Phew. That's one side done.
I'm gonna get this off.
Yeah. Oh, you can hear it sizzling. There it is. It's gone.
Yeah, I just wasn't tight enough.
That one didn't pop off like as nice.
I don't think I tightened it because I'm erring on the side of being not too tight.
You know.
That's
a good call.
Moving a little bit. Does it line up?
Yeah. I just can't help but move your arm.
You can tell the bushing is like broken and.
Yeah, the inside of it is so jacked, dude.
Plus, like,
it's like growing. She's growing! This sleeve didn't come out at all, did it? Yeah, that's not gonna go. Oh, I lied. JK. You're going in the car, you're a troublemaker.
See, there's a little bit off on this one. It's hitting right there.
Yeah.
Wanted to be a little more centered.
There you go, perfect, perfect.
There it is, a little bit, a little tiny bit more.
Down?
No, like a millimeter in, just towards the engine.
Ah!
Ross, you're still good.
Okay.
I'm gonna try pushing the cam sleeve. Yes, there we go.
Okay, I gotta get it to where this thing's twisted up. Okay, that's close right there. Okay, so we got it all back together. It was a little bit of a fight, but with four extra sets of hands from Sean and Fred, whose truck we're working on, we're able to get the bushings pushed out, everything back together. Worked out pretty good, I would have to say, all in all. What was interesting is when we put his tires back on and we got it all back on the ground, his camber was way off. His tires were going out like this. So we just basically manually adjusted. We loosened the adjusters and pushed out on the adjustment so it brought it back more perpendicular to the ground. So like his wheels were like this and now we brought them parallel. So if you're really off and you can't get to alignment shop right away and you got to drive for a little bit, just eyeball it, you know, adjust them equally front and rear. So we were off by like 3 degrees or 3 notches on those cam adjusters. So we just turned them both equally on both the front and the rear on the lower control arms on both sides. And now the wheels look like they're tracking much better, more even on the ground. So that's something to think about, just to eyeball it. I don't know why it was like that, but maybe it was because his bushings were a little worn out. The last alignment wasn't that good. So anyways, thank you for watching Toyota Time with Timmy the Tool Man. We will be back with more videos.
Bye, guys.
Okay. Thanks for watching. So the repair was a success. We got the white line polyurethane bushings installed in Fred's lower control arms. Our technique for removing them did work. What we learned online from a couple dudes that posted a YouTube video actually worked really well by getting the bottle jack between the arms, applying a moderate amount of pressure, and then heating up the lower control arm enough to where it breaks free the metal sleeve, and then you could just push it out. So that worked out really well. Then getting the new bushing pushed in, you could do it right in a vise like this. Would it be a lot nicer to actually have a regular press? Of course it would, but not everybody owns a press. So if you have a nice vise like this, you can do it this way, or if you could also rig up something with a screw bar. I've seen all kinds of different ways, ingenious ways people make do with what they got. So we chose to do it with a vise to press the new bushings in, and it worked fine by using the channel locks in place to give it a little bit of space for it to be pressed in. So it worked out. We learned all this online from other people that have gone before us and done the same job, and we chose the technique that we liked best. When we were all said and done, what was interesting is that we match marked the cam adjusters, and we copied those match marks onto the new cam adjusters that he bought for this job. And when it was all said and done and all back together, his camber was way off. His wheels were like this, kind of cocked out. The tops were out a little bit, so his camber was way off. So we loosened the cam adjusters, and then we adjusted it by about like three clicks, like three notches on each one. We adjusted the front one and the rear one on each side, on the driver's side and passenger side, and brought it back in to eyeball it. And so what anybody that does this job has to do is get it close and then go to an alignment shop and get your truck aligned. You don't want to just like leave it eyeballed. So go and get an alignment by a professional with a machine. But you can get it pretty close just by eyeballing to see that the wheels are tracking straight up and down against the ground. That's what you want. I hope you learned something. If you have any questions, please comment. Thank you for watching Toyota Time with Timmy the Tool Man. Thanks for watching. We will be back with more videos.
Bye, guys.
Okay. Thanks for watching. So, Fred, we're basically doing both the each other a favor. Fred's letting us work on his truck so we can make another cool video for you to watch. And we're helping out Fred do some work on his truck, because right now he doesn't have a garage to work in where he lives in Sacramento. And so we're helping him out in that way. So, Fred, you do understand that we, Sean and I, are not paid mechanics. We're not a paid shop with insurance. We're just a couple dudes that like to work on our Toyota 4Runners. And that we want to help you out, and at the same time you're helping us out making a cool video. And so you have to be part of this process. You have to watch everything that we're doing, that you have to be okay with the you know, where we're torquing everything, and watch that we're putting all the bolts and nuts back on the truck, that we're not going to have a wheel fall off on you on the freeway back going back home. And so just let me ask you this. So Fred, you understand that you know, we're just a couple regular dudes, and we're hoping you don't try to sue us if something goes wrong.
Basically. No, I'm out of here. No, I'm kidding. Yeah, I get it.
Okay, we're good. All right, we're going to get going on this. Here we go.
Sean already did a premature cotton removal. You got a problem with premature cotton removal? Okay. And